And so many times you think you have it all figured out, the predictions are there. There's a reason 99% of the pick-ems are already in shambles or something.
99.97% of people already have the pick-ems wrong.
And anybody that predicted them right was probably just under influence, honestly, because there's no way you could have predicted the way Worlds played out.
We're going to continue to have interesting surprises here as we get ourselves into the pick and ban phase. TSM removing some of the champions that Splice are known for or have shown and demonstrated very large skill on with the Kassadin and the Jace gone.
Yeah, getting rid of Sentcooks 1-3-1, getting rid of the Jace that was dominant in the lane last game. Splice heavily targeting Svenskeren's early game invading junglers. So very heavily in the target ban right now between TSM and Splice.
Oh, this will be a first rotation Aurelion Sol by Splice. They have to ban Syndra here, I feel. So they have to ban Syndra against Bjergsen because I don't think they actually have a reply ready. And then you could see maybe an Aurelion Sol first pick for TSM as well, because this pick will go through. And it's Splice's favorite champion, I feel, to play in the mid lane, because it's just, it allows Sentcooks to help in a different way. Just push in and roll.
This is nice. I actually think this is interesting because you can trade mid laners and then take Kennen top
that
and
plan.
Leave no rumble up. So Syndra's the first pick, but this is Aurelion Sol Kennen.
Yeah, and this is about Sentcooks being able to play Aurelion Sol, because you can still split the... That's the thing that would happen when a lot of these teams are playing Scrims, is they think that Aurelion Sol is the pick to neutralize against Syndra because of the early lane shove, and the item path you go on it, you would go Spectre's Cal into Catalyst and pretty much just tank and shove, but they can wait for later for that, and they're getting their power picks now.
Exactly, because with this Syndra locked in early, it's not like there's going to be an Aurelion Sol support come out. They can wait, get some value picks here. They could still technically flex the Karma if they find themselves in a bind, but it is so likely that that Karma is going to the support lane for Kabi and Mickey to just AFK shove in the bot lane.
Yeah. Karma is a champion that could survive Syndra's all-in. Builds some natural MR if she goes for the Athene's build, but you're right. We expect the bot lane, great lane dominance. We've seen the Splice duo bounce back from a rough laning phase. Last week, we saw them do well against TSM's 2-on-2 already, and pick a good matchup, might just win again.
And they break apart the Syndra-Elise combo that has proven so lethal in Worlds already just by taking that pick away, and now they force TSM. Are they going to go for the OAuth again, or are they just going to start pivoting?
Because of the fact that they're breaking up the Syndra-Elise combo and they banned the most proficient early game junglers aside from that, I think Splice has actually won the early part of this draft, assuming Sentcooks is good at Aurelion Sol.
Yeah.
Get the Jhin for themselves here. All right, so utility is there for Double FT. Will not be the hard carry. Jhin can, but it's less likely to be the case. Might even be a losing lane matchup. The Rek'Sai is back in for Svenskeren, so he has some early pressure. We'll see if he can use it.
The other pick we've seen into Syndra that has been fairly effective has been Vladimir. And Vladimir is good if they get to the teamfight phase against both Syndra and the Jhin. So there's a chance they go with this as well, but it's a tricky early game.
Statistically, yes, but I feel if you watch every game, Vladimir has only done well when the Syndra has neglected to play on her strengths. Which is, if a Syndra sits into lane and eventually lets the Vladimir get into the game, yes. But if the Syndra goes for the push and the roam and starts assisting these other lanes, she gets such a large benefit for the team that this Vladimir pick just doesn't have the influence. So I'm actually quite surprised that Splice as a team valued the Rumble ban over the Syndra ban and let TSM have that Syndra first pick, and they didn't match it with a creative counter pick, and they just did another iteration of the Vladimir Syndra matchup.
You also have to look though at how Splice won their game against RNG, where they picked losing matchups against the other team's strengths and then tried to win everywhere else on the map. In a sense, that's what they could be doing against TSM here, and hoping that Sentcooks can keep Bjergsen at least a little bit under control. It's definitely a bold strategy.
Yeah, we saw Bjergsen get solo killed just about 2 hours ago by Crown in the mid lane, so maybe he's a little bit off his game and Sentcooks can make this happen. Of course, Sentcooks himself definitely played very well in his previous showing on the Rift. And we have to see. Ezreal picked up alongside to go alongside the Vladimir. Plenty of damage now available to Splice. They're waiting on their top lane pick as well, which will give them counter pick in pretty much every single lane here. Showing these champions, Vlad into Syndra, top lane waiting.
Could be the ultimate curveball. Top lane Vladimir. Seen it once.
Amazing J, is that you? I'm in the top lane. Amazing J did play it in the LPL playoffs. Wonder has played carry tops in the past. I think it's a little unlikely, to say the least.
I just want to see some Aurelion Sol, man. But it's not going to happen.
Definitely a fun champion, but you're right. It seems pretty unlikely here at this point. Instead, they're saying, you know, it might be a losing matchup a little bit, but the Poppy might work well.
I really don't want to see Poppy here from Splice, because that makes their mid and top side of the map get shoved pretty substantially early on in the game. I would much rather see them even though Aurelius had some losing games against Gnar, play Aurelia or play Kled and at least have a little bit more aggression in the lane phase if comboed with the Elise.
Really, it is. So, a lane you've got to play aggressively in order to win, and Wonder so far has played very well. We saw that in the game against Royal. If you put up the same performance, he can absolutely smash this lane against Haunter.
Getting a lot of pressure here on Thrashy in the early game. Maybe Yamato kind of gave him a little tweak, said, you know, one camp less earlier gank, go out, try and surprise here. Any early gank can stick here. But it almost guaranteed has to be in the top lane. Aurelia level 3 plus Elise coming in is such a potent lane combo. Yes, you won't get the Equilibrium Strike stun out, but you can just get the slow, which is enough for Elise to approach with red buff and then save the cocoon for off and flash.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Aurelia does have this window of time where she can beat the Gnar. It's generally before Gnar is level 7 or 8 and picked up some armor items, but early on, even if Gnar is shoving in, that actually makes it so your Equilibrium Strike can stun, and it combos even better with the Elise. So it's a very dangerous lane for Haunter early on in the game.
So definite threat on the TSM top lane. We've seen Wonder win lane before. He might do it here as well. He's been given the champion to do so, and he's also got that early pick Elise on Trash. You mentioned the pressure on him. The theoretically advantageous jungle matchup. You're expecting top lane to win for Splice. We'll see if they can do it, because piloting it is the important part. So, throughout the tournament, we are always on the lookout for your contributions at home on Twitter. Hit us up at LOE Sports and call out your favorite moments from Worlds 2016 using the hashtag WorldsBigPlays. As always, cheer on your favorite teams as well. We had cheers for Splice, but we're also in TSM's hometown of sorts. And here we go into our third game of the day. We are set for explosive matches as TSM takes on Splice.
And it is so important that TSM succeed for their organization. They failed to make it outside of group stage last year. They dropped the first game of the day to Samsung. But because Splice took down RNG, if TSM win the next two games, they're in two quarters without any tiebreakers having to be played to make it in.
And it's so interesting from a pressure point of view. Splice came into the day, I wouldn't say with nothing to lose, but with very little to lose, much to gain. TSM came into the day with almost everything to lose. Running up to Worlds, they were honestly maybe the fourth rated team in terms of even title favorites, because you had the likes of SKT, Rocks Tigers, EDG then, but then it was a steep drop-off and nobody really knew who's next in line there. TSM looked so fantastic.
Nice.
But if they want to live up to that expectation, they need to perform in this match.
And they've been very clear with their expectations for themselves. Anything less than top four at Worlds would be considered a failure. But they're in a place now where they are two wins and two losses, and they must perform.
So a lot of threat on this game. Teams trying to figure out how they're going to pivot at the very beginning of this one. You're looking at TSM considering whether or not they want to start on the Krugs down here, and with the early Trinket Ward kill, it looks like Splice will be too gun-shy to face-check into them.
Yeah, I wonder
if... will be extra XP.
Yeah, sorry for interrupting. I wonder if Splice is going for the little freeze here. Yeah. Mickey X in the bot lane. You see him move out of the brush here. So they're just going to deny a couple of melee creeps here, hoping that by the time Doublelift and Bifrost are finished, they lose a creep here. It's going to be close.
Yeah, at least one.
And then they can walk up and zone here because they're playing melee into double range. Now let's see how well their zone game is.
And if Kabi last hits well enough, like slowly enough, he can keep the wave far away, but already they push Mickey out.
Basically what it does is it prevents Doublelift from leveling up on that creep that he just killed, which means he actually gets zoned a little more. They wait until the next wave settles in, and it makes it very manageable. In addition to the fact that Byrefrost already used one potion.
Nice dodge.
And he ate like two Qs. So right now, Splice, they're playing the sustain game. In raw terms of experience, yes, they're slightly behind, but they have the lane control, they have the push, and they have the sustain.
And now if we match it by levels, the next time TSM would be able to bounce back in this lane is around level 3 if a Rek'Sai were to approach in the gank. So the early lane definitely going to Splice.
We'll see how much more they can get then with this one. The lane is going to start to push into the turret. Haunter in the trade. Wonder gets the stun. Dodges away from the clock tower. Nicely done.
He has been juking spectacularly in the last few games. Olaf axes to save him last game to ganks, and there are two slick skill shot dodges right at the start.
And it speaks to the comfort that Splice is playing with. I feel they were much more under pressure last week, feeling like they had to make something happen. But in a sense, the 0-3 kind of liberated them. If they went 0-6, it's kind of what people expected. But at least you want to go down shining. You want to make a fancy play at least.
And last game was such a feel-good game for Splice, capitalizing on all of their strengths against RNG, doing well enough in lanes, and then making a great 1-3-1 happen. Now it's about, can they extend it and actually make some noise in this group?
Good ward. They see Trashy. Haunzer doesn't give it away too badly, actually. Not rushing back. He's going to let Trashy waste some time.
Super recent ward here, so that's a bit of an error in communication. Wunder should be able to track the movement of a Gnar to the point where the ward is a very likely place. Trashy wasting quite some time here. Let's see if Svensken can use it to his advantage. And maybe I'll tempo.
You've had a nice little play by Haunzer. He walked down what looked like to be faking putting a ward down, trying to like mess with their timing and say, oh, it wasn't warded, I just outplayed you.
Yeah.
Wunder gets chunked.
It could have been a bait onto Trashy, because Svensken was coming to try and get the kill, and luckily for Splice, they don't take that bait, but it definitely helps the early laning phase for TSM. When Gnar was needing to be pushed up, they had the ward and the jungle support there, so they understand the timings of the matchup.
And if Haunzer is very skilled in kind of doing the mental math in terms of camps, he knows Trashy is now forced to do two camps and kind of path to the right side of the map there, and he actually will be avoiding ganks for the next few minutes, so that little phase is very well played by TSM.
Bjergsen open a push into the jungle, push Trashy around, can't do that just yet. He made an early recall around wave 3, got an extra Doran's Ring, and was given the blue buff. So Bjergsen will have the next minute and a half of lane control, and maybe he can join Svensken, but that's going to be an engage by Trashy, getting plenty of damage down. 200 HP left on the Rek'Sai, has to flash, but Trashy could join up soon. He has flash of himself, and the heal's not going to come down in time. First blood, but it's an exhaust into a stun, into a very dead Elise, and down the water spout she goes. TSM getting a kill back.
TSM had the shove in the bottom lane and the mid lane, which is why Svensken thought he'd be able to make the invade, but it wasn't in time to save him from that first blood.
A lot of summoners, though, were burned by TSM in a turn that went around in time. Trashy could have said, okay, you burn flash, I walk away. Instead, trades kills, but gets way more summoners out of it.
Yeah, it's 6 summoners to 1, which is a gargantuan difference when you're considering early game usage. That means Trashy's next game can be much more effective.
And then we need to look at the information that was on the table for TSM. Bjergsen is just checking Raptors. They're gone, so they should actually be ready for the potential that Trashy is in that rush. Yeah. But Svensken just saw him very late right there because Trashy wasn't moving much. And honestly, a very bold invade here. His mid laner is on the left side of the map invading, and he's going on the right side.
Exactly, and in this situation, there's a lot of little things that happen. Trashy could have been starting on the Wolves, which is why Svensken was looking to invade. Trashy made the call to think of an invade because people are kind of used to Svensken always being super aggressive. Then, Biofrost could have flashed early and got the shield in front and potentially saved Svensken's life, but Trashy was the first one to pull the trigger on that flash, gets the first blood, and I think overall it's worth it, even if they gave a kill back to Bjergsen.
Definitely agree, but we sit in a game with a 300 lead. Trashy, though, has nowhere to really jump to. Is it going to be the stun? The ulti coming across, there's the jump, and that's one kill picked up. Svensken gets the credit, though Bjergsen did all the hard work.
And this is DSM resorting back to what they were so good at, is in unison together they will invade. Svensken and Bjergsen become a tandem, and they both move in together, combining their champion strengths and weaknesses.
And when the trade is 6 summoner spells to 1, TSM zeroing out the 1 summoner spell and punishing it, whereas Trashy wasn't able to do so, is incredibly key in swinging that early game.
And it gets even worse. Trashy rushed mobility boots to hunt for that advantageous gank, you know, to really drive it home, and he got punished super hard on his next camp.
It's the ability in the last game as well. Moby boots into the movement speed AP item. I'm blanking the name. Aether Wisp, I think it's called. And he tries to get into those lanes and find those pressure points. Killing the ward right now and finding what else he can do.
And when Elise as a champion falls behind early, you do not get back into the game by farming more. You have to go for another gank. So the next few minutes are so incredibly important here for Splice. They need to get Trashy back into the game. They need to make something happen, because otherwise those 6 summoner spells that were used will not come at a single cost for TSM.
Halfway back, a double is flash. Even closer on Biofrost with his exhaust and flash of his own. Yeah, that might not get punished at all. The question is whether they can track Trashy. The engage towards the Splice's dual lane, pretty much non-existent. Do you want to talk about the top lane matchup? We haven't watched it much, and it's plus 17, 18 right now for Wunder. This matchup has done well for the Splice top lane. It's keeping the game quite a bit closer. We see him go in for the slow and forcing the hop out of Haunzer.
And Aurelia has a large amount of threat, especially when there's the minion wave of this size, because if Haunzer does want to return auto attacks, he has to back away. Not to mention, even with some deep vision in the jungle, Haunzer always has to be wary of the Elise gank, since the damage potential of an early game Aurelia is so high. This is why the Aurelia can win the matchup. It's about kills. Ooh.
Stun and the Q gonna land afterwards. At least Haunzer gets a little bit of damage through, but absolutely, Haunzer doing okay for himself. Wunder doing even better.
And we're approaching the point of the game where Doublelift and Biofrost are gonna hit level 6 there, and they actually get a really favorable matchup in terms of all-in. Because Karma doesn't get access to more power. Ezreal gets the ulti, but it's hard negated by a Brock shield.
Again, still my flash. Down.
Smites it away though, gets the red buff completely secure, walks away pretty cleanly. He was on a pink ward, that's a deep one by TSM, but now it's a roam to the top side. Ghost popped by Bjergsen. Wonder's gonna have to dodge this stun somehow, and he does flash to get away from it. Trash is there to help, he should be fine.
Beautiful timing by Wonder on avoiding that stun. He knew that Bjergsen was gonna be trying to land it, and Bjergsen was trying to be patient too, yep, by throwing the W first, but then Wonder just wins the mind game, able to react as soon as he sees the animation and flash away.
Bjergsen did everything right. You throw a W hoping they'll panic flash so you can QE right after, but then he waited long enough, he juked the W itself and then flashed the remaining part of the engage here. Perfect play by Wonder.
There is a move that Scout pulled off earlier where you can throw your W in one spot and the Q where the flash would be and then E at the same time to try and catch up with a stun either way, but that's thinking a little bit too far ahead. It could have been possible.
It was, but it didn't happen. And it's just going to be the loss of flash for Bjergsen's ghost in the roam out.
Critical moment here in the game, though. That's exactly what we were talking about earlier. The hard negation of the ultimate here with the Braum shield. If that scene happens in an all-in, suddenly TSM pulls ahead because when Splice have to run, they're running away from Curtain Call here. Mm-hmm. So bot lane actually has deceivingly large kill pressure in this matchup. The top lane triangle is winning for TSM, so despite the gold being only 800 gold difference, I feel like TSM is much more in control of the game right now.
They are, and so much of that is because Trashy's lost control of his jungle. This is the game where Svenskeren can get his counter jungling and deep warding game on. The question will be whether or not they can transition that to actually getting some kills on that side of the map, or if Splice can actually go bottom and try and get some kills on Doublelift and Biofrost. Well, unlikely Trashy, though, with the Summoners.
Yeah, if Trashy does, he is alone. His entire dual lane recalled. TSM know they're under almost zero threat at all. Biofrost kills the ward amidst the recall from the JD carry, and they're going to be fine, but yeah, talking about Trashy losing his jungle, that is largely Bjergsen winning his lane, getting the shove advantage.
I think TSM is about to roam up top again. They got the push because Splice went to bot, which means TSM get the push mid, which means they can move into the enemy jungle and roam top. Go flash on Wonder.
Exactly. He's flashless. This ward is still up. They are able to track most of what Trashy's movements would be.
Making R for about another 5 seconds. I don't think the time is going to quite work out for them.
He's going to get the stun actually in time, just barely. Now time for the knockup into the stun, into the unleashed power not even needed, and a very clean tower dive by TSM.
The last fraction of a second that Haunter could get the Mega Gnar, he casted, immediately hops back to Mini Gnar, and it was so clean because Svenskeren and Bjergsen didn't take a single hit of damage, which means they can immediately go back to their lanes and not lose the pressure you'd expect when there's a double roam into a turret dive.
They can even pressure Trashy out of his own jungle and take away his Raptor camp, the big part of it, so more grabbed by the TSM duo here.
And there's no reaction of the same sort for Splice. The Elise and Vladimir are not in a position to roam bot. Even if they would make it there, it's so hard to dive that particular matchup itself, so TSM really leaning on their strengths, and again, this brings us back to Champion Select. Was it worth handing over Syndra over to TSM?
And it's looking like TSM is making the pay for it. The critical difference, I feel like, when Splice gives the other teams strong lanes where they could potentially be weak versus this one, is against RNG, Mata and Uzi weren't going to roam around on Karma and Caitlyn and affect the rest of the map. But when Bjergsen is on Syndra and he's able to affect the other lanes, the problem isn't isolated to a specific part and it spreads to the rest of the game.
Yeah, I mean, you saw it before, knock into the wall, chain succeed. Even if Haunter doesn't get that knock off, it's still going to be at least a 1-for-1. That's just a really solid play for TSM with such a low risk of failure.
Absolutely agree. The matchups that TSM have gotten the early game jungle, the winning lane matchup, Svenskeren and Bjergsen can walk top lane whenever they deign, whenever they want to. They're up there and they can start punishing Wonder. You can see, because of the influx of gold, Haunter having a better time trading back and forth. Kabi has to arcane shift that. Well played by him. Biofrost will get rid of that pink ward, gets replaced.
And again, Bjergsen roaming with Svenskeren.
And Sengkooks is just sitting in the mid lane right now. They open up and are looking to at least burn summoners, hopefully getting kills.
Mickey is alone under his turret. Here comes the dynamic duo looking for it. Mickey gonna get hit up. Couple more snipes to go, and that's gonna be a kill to Doublelift. Gold flowing into every lane now. Three of TSM's members have kills.
It could be a race for the first turret here, though, as TSM might want to get the bottom as Splice is now going for Haunter.
Looking for the big play on the Haunter, but Trashy can't get a range for the stun.
They abandoned the race because there was only four creeps left, and that's not enough with two members to get that turret. And even if Trashy goes into spider form to get spiders up, that means Haunter could technically approach here.
I don't know. It's still looking pretty risky. Top's getting lower and lower, and I think it's actually a fairly close race. You're seeing the Spiderlings were up for part of it.
The base race cam to see who can get it first. Splice!
Splice gets it by just a few seconds. That's actually a pretty crucial influx of gold.
That actually means that it was a very risky play to actually go for the zone on Also, there's Splice looking for more than just a race.
And part of it was that Bjergsen also walked back to mid lane, right? Like, every way they sort of pushed in the resources, TSM just ended up being 2 seconds slow. Ooh, nice steal! An early smite for Svenskir means Kabi gets it with a Mystic Shot.
Yeah, you take the 90 gold from the Gromp and the 400 gold from the first turret. That's actually a 1,000 gold difference that TSM could be ahead of if a few things go differently. So very critical that Splice can stay in the game with those small margins, as they were very close to being completely snowballed on, and now they still actually have a bit more chance.
And no immediate power on the dragon. It comes later on turret sieges and maybe objective contestation, but right now there's no elemental drake here that gives you immediate bonuses to Splice. They have a few windows to get back in.
Here comes the roam. They want Bjergsen. He has to flash the cocoon. Saw it coming. And Trashy, good job getting rid of that summoner spell. The repeat gank the next 4 minutes could be very good.
Yeah, it does hurt Trash that he had to burn his flash on the way out, because now he can't necessarily flash cocoon to get a guaranteed kill onto Bjergsen, but still a valuable roam by Splice.
See if they can get it. Roams weren't built in just a day. Sometimes you got to take a bit longer to make them happen. Sendcook's around the wall, suddenly surrounded. Stun's gonna land. That's the cue for Biofrost. They've got all the CC they need. Bio steals the kill, didn't need to. Unlucky there, but it is a nice pickoff.
Yeah, they chain CC'd him. I think the reason everyone on TSM was hitting him so hard is because it was the Cinder stun into the Braum stun, and they were worried he was gonna pool flash away. But Sendcook never flashes or pools early, and he pays the price.
Right now, Krepo's checking to see if he had people walk through Fog of War, and he actually saw plenty of people just too long.
Yeah. He saw the
greedy play.
He saw the support come from one side, so he thought it was fine, but then they came around the mid lane wall. Can't afford to have him. Bjergsen playing with no flash so far.
Oh, nice rappel. Trashy jukes it away. Gets the trade kill back in. Nicely done. Splice trying to claw back to this game, but it is a 2,000 gold deficit. Now Wonder in the top lane does have flash. Will he be forced to use it? Yes, he's going to finally jump over that small part of the wall. I was hoping he wasn't going to get chained slow, but he was.
Haunter has the frozen mallet. Wonder was definitely extended too far, but Bjergsen was also extended too far. He had wards on the right side. He was too close to the left when pushing up there, and he gets cocooned from the Fog of War.
And this is the way Splice deal with problems. One big Bjergsen that pushes in. Well, we're going to put three members against him, put the Vladimir on a slide lane. This is, again, Splice opting for the 1v1 very early in the game here. Good cocoon, and just as you mentioned earlier, he dodges most of the damage with the repel while still going forward for the kill here. Three-man squad. Very tough to deal with a single Syndra, though. Mm-hmm.
It's actually Nikki to land just slow on the Fog, and TSM really trying to get something. Trashy no flash.
Slow one, slow two, slow three. Four shots going to land on a Trashy, but now will he survive the encounter? A big knockup comes out of Biofrost, and that should be enough to knock down the Elise, but Rappel's going to buy a few more seconds, and the resnipe comes through, but it's too early. And here's the re-engage on the backside. They've picked off Double Lift. It's now a 4v4, and Hemo Plague is on. Sendcux is poised to do so much damage here with help from Wonder. They've already picked up another. That's 2-1 in favor of Splice. 2-2, actually. They did pick off Mickey.
That's still exactly the type of fight that Splice would want. It's messy, it's protracted, and then Sendcooks can go in the back, get onto Jhin, and get a kill.
Messy, but also very calculated, because they peel away the Vladimir from one lane. He is not running teleport. He didn't even ghost into that fight. And as he peeled in, they teleport from the other lane. So while they were super spread out on the map, 1-3-1, they suddenly collapse as a five-man unit and surprise TSM.
Yeah, and this feels like it keeps happening to TSM so far at Worlds here, where they'll get a small edge pushed a little bit too far, and the opponent team will counter them where they're just not used to being countered in North America. So here we can see it one more time.
Yeah, look where Vladimir actually starts. He starts in the bot lane, moves over, there's a teleport. Let's see where it actually comes out. There's some wards behind, so the shallow wards into the enemy jungle here. Double completely surprised, moving away from Sendcooks, but then suddenly, as he casts a W, Wunder comes out, and if you give an Aurelia access to a low mobility carry in the background, he can almost solo it.
Yep.
There was no teleport on Haunter's Gnar. If Doublelift is going to approach, they would need to have knowledge of that ward, so to speak, but it just completely surprised them.
And that's props to Splice, for despite being behind in this game a good 2,000 gold, even more than this at this point, they got that deep ward that allowed that teleport to happen, not letting up in the game and, you know, losing all their vision control.
And by putting three mid, they're actually challenging Bjergsen at least a little bit on the roaming. If he wants to go to a side lane, he's only finding one isolated target that can usually back off. TSM are still aggressively contesting in the jungle, though.
It's a blue buff steal, nicely played. And this is the thing, is if you're the team with the gold lead, you're just supposed to win any given 5-on-5 or 2-on-2 or 3-on-3. And so TSM pushing their weight around to the right places where they are going to match up well enough and get those advantages and continue to push forward.
Yeah, if TSM can get their hands on a Rift Herald in the next 2 minutes, it would be really important because it would mean side lane priority, but they seem very much so dragged towards the bottom side of the map, really challenging Vladimir, who has to get up close to the mini wave if he wants to clear it. 4v2 here.
See what they can get. Senkuk's juking back and forth, hoping to clear some minions under this turret, but the wave clear not honestly amazing from Splice. TSM have a pretty good amount of siege. The minions are back in. You can see if minions, melee minions are allowed to hit a turret, that means your wave clear is bad. And that is the case with this team comp.
Right, but even with that, they only get a couple of shots on the turret. Jhin at this point in the game, not the greatest at killing turrets. They don't want to overextend too much in fear of maybe throwing the game away. That has to be in the back of their mind after so many fights go wrong. At this point, though, they have a whole bunch of wards in the jungle of Splice, the blue buff, and they're probably going for Ocean Drake in about 40 seconds.
Yeah, Triforce with some lifesteal here on Wunder. He's always leaving himself exit creeps. Good read from Hanser. He knows that Wunder is actually trying to dodge the boulders by dashing to the creeps. If you play against an Irelia, you always have to be mindful of what is her exit path. If you can somehow screw that up, make her waste a Q bounce,
They're going to land the root. They're going to land the slows. They should chain the CC pretty easily here. And this one, one more snipe will do it. And Doublelift gets his second kill. Nicely done.
And I can see why Wunder died there. He was not expecting the duo lane roam when Drake is up in 10 seconds. TSM had just made the prep play for top lane. So a really peculiar roam top from Senkuk, or from Wunder's perspective. And it pays off for TSM.
It's really beautiful. Taking the expected play and saying, we're not going to do that. We'll do something else. Oh! The one shot from Bjergsen takes him out, and now Trashy also in a bad spot. Svenskeren on the chase with the Randuin slow, with the red buff, the follow through from Bjergsen. That's already two kills, and Mickey now running for his life.
Bjergsen Syndra just has so much pressure because he's able to hold the mid lane one versus three. Earlier, it allows TSM to put three members in the top lane and get a kill. And then after that, when Svenskeren moves down, he can just one-shot obliterate Kabi right now, and that's all falling apart from Splice. And again, you have to question the pick. Syndra on Bjergsen is just too damn strong.
Such massive playmaking across the board from TSM, though. When the game was looking a little bit questionable, they make the big play. Splice trying to come back.
Splice looking for one themselves, but Senkuk stunned up, gonna lose out.
Here comes Meganar.
Pull away. Yes, here comes Meganar, but it's not the most beautiful. A quick stun and a wonder. Bit of damage. Look at the follow through. A bounce house for TSM. It's already two. And the turret nearly falls as well.
And you have the perfect word there. It's a bounce house right now. Just chaining the CC over and over again onto Splice.
And they got the slow. They got the chase then into Senkuk's. Not going to get too much more, but the crowd practically on their feet now, cheering for TSM, hoping that the North American hopeful can continue their run for a quarterfinal spot.
And that was honestly fantastic. That scoop initially didn't look too great, but followed up by one CC and another, and perfectly layered over and over. And then a couple of spheres from Bjergsen just launched forward, double stun, double kill.
Yeah, the first stun, I believe, into the Braum ultimate, into the Rek'Sai knockup, all the while hitting them with circular damage. Mickey as well.
Oh, he's so dead.
If you're new to Splice, the Mickey X special. Walk into Fog of War.
TSM hoping to play with confidence. And I think 3 minutes ago, this game was incredibly dangerous for TSM, because if you think about this game moving towards the late game, if it does get close, the Aurelia and the Vladimir combo so well into the Syndra and the Jhin. But this play right here, he gets the priority target that he needs to, and this is after TSM had already picked up the Aurelia in the top lane.
But this is with Mickey X walking around in range with exhaust available. You should never let your AD carry die if you're playing 3v1 and you have exhaust, because if Bjergsen doesn't get that kill, suddenly Kabi can finish him off on the back end of that plane, because Syndra has cooldowns. Mm-hmm.
And this is an I-think-I-can mentality from Splice. They don't want to give up the turret despite having two people respawning on the map. Wunder goes a little bit in. They get a bunch of CC chain onto Senkuk. He ults, so he thinks he's safe. But then Meganar comes in, and when Haunter doesn't hit the Meganar, Splice still kind of think they're safe. They should have just been fully running away, but Mickey gets caught in the bounce house. Everyone goes down.
Just a dirty sequence there from TSM. And now, fully in control of the game. Looked a little bit close from Splice. Honestly, that rotation where three people surprised Wunder in the top lane was the tipping point. That's where TSM took control again of the game.
And it was good on TSM to finally have a better looking mid game. The mid game is where they actually lost to Samsung around that 20-minute mark. A stun on Akobi, not too much more gain off that one, but it's just Splice backs against the wall. If they lose this game, they cannot make the quarterfinals here at Worlds. They'd be capped at two maximum wins. They'd already be two teams of three.
Yeah, and from TSM's perspective, they need to be strong in this stage of the game.
And they've already knocked down one member for it. The turret's going to be up next. It can't even run away, so unlucky there in this one. Svenskeren going to weather the storm. The damage not going to be enough for him. Plenty of orbs available.
She's coming in behind him.
Has the ulti. A bit of a slow on Ascend. Cooks more damage. Sengu pulls out of there, but now that means he's an available target for that unleashed power. Here comes the engage tools. It's double lift with the curtain call. Gets the slows on a wonder. Gets plenty of damage. Mickey gonna get away, but he's not gonna be so lucky for the top laner. That's two dead already. Another trade kill. More in for Bjergsen. Four versus two right now.
Just a snowballing Cinder right now. Nine kills, also making it so difficult for Splice to escape.
You can definitely still see that Bjergsen is the central axis that TSM is playing around. He's involved in 14 out of 16 kills right now. He is the one driving the game home. Initially relying on his push into roam ability, but now in the fights, landing stun after stun after stun.
And last game was Splice capitalizing on all their strengths from the European LCS split. This is TSM playing like they did when they dominated North America. They are a mid-game team with such a low average game time. It's because they can make these plays happen. They are aggressive even when even in numbers. They get the stun of the Trashy, immediately follow up. And then as this play extends, actually, they dive through the turret because they know what their priorities are.
Yeah, they have a super strong poke and siege composition, you know, with Deadly Flourish, with the massive range on that Syndra QE combo. And then if people start running, the curtain call is enough to facilitate the chase here. Firefrost not afraid to go for the aggressive ultimate either here. TSM, mostly rolling over Splice.
Oh, and Kavi gets hit by the deadly flirt, and it's going to be just that load. Ulted, goodbye. Double lift on a killing spree now. And look at the Mega Gnar catches several of Splice. They're going to run out of health. That's several more. Look at that, a 3-0 in the blink of an eye.
It just keeps coming. TSM has so much hit potential with the Jhin and the Syndra right now, with Biofrost jumping over the top on all of these fights. Three kills now, 25-minute Baron should be an afterthought.
Almost no chance losing it here. Two members alive, no teleport up on either. A flash, not going to mean much. Haunzer solo zoning out the 1v2 as TSM quietly takes down Baron Nashor in the darkness, in the fog of war. There it's picked up, 25 minutes, 37 seconds. Baron buff up, 11,000 gold lead.
Definitely lights out for Splicer. Just so little they can do. TSM team comp in the mid game snowball so well. Nobody actually cares about the red buff. It's about the kills that ensue. Kabe forced to use his gap closer once. Has flash, but try to
once you get hit by one,
it's over.
Yep.
The Braum stun, the Rek'Sai knockup, the Cinder comes in over the top. Haunter gets Mega. Guess what? He lands the one stun against the wall. Everything else chains.
TSM learning the lesson they were rudely reminded of in their Samsung game, where they just did not have enough crowd control, enough ways to start the fights out. This time, every single member on TSM has some way to say, we are fighting now, 5-on-5, let's go, run away and die, or fight us head on. And those have been very well orchestrated so far. The Baron buff, the question now is, how long does it take for TSM to kill off the Nexus? They are almost definitely guaranteed this one. They are almost guaranteed to send Splice home without a quarterfinal spot. They got that upset win over Royal, but if Splice cannot make the comeback, they cannot make quarters.
And it makes up for TSM failing a little bit in the first game of the day, in their opinion. The fact that Royal took that hit earlier.
A lot looking around the side. Wonder looking for the play into Bjergsen, but now a chase over Haunzer. But he's going to try to pick up the mid laner. Can't even do it. The damage is too high. Hemo Plague not going to be enough either. And the shields came on enough. Now the retreat, because Kabi wants in on the double lift. How's that duel going to go? Dodges one Q. Looks to dodge the next. One more shot will kill him. The flash. Oh, and double lift gets him inside the base. Doesn't take enough damage to die.
And it just shows you what could have been if the Aurelia was a little bit more even with Bjergsen. That's exactly how Splice would want to fight in the late game. But they're going up against a gargantuan gold lead here for TSM.
And they're looking for even more. Haunzer jumps in, forces out the Sanguine Pool from Senkux. And it's going to be the bottom inhibitor gone. The mid lane inhibitor soon to follow. Baron buff still on for over a minute with two inhibs down and 14,000 gold, putting TSM ahead.
very important they also win this game quickly, because average win time is one of the cedars for tiebreakers if we get a three-way tie. Although maybe that's not important anymore. They're going for the game.
Yeah, right now they're looking to close things out, but a quick shutdown comes through. It's going to be a trade kill, but still nice by Wedder to make the play. Even still, Trashy has already found his grave for the seventh time this game. TSM on to the Nexus turret. Svenskeren barely even taking damage from these Nexus turrets here as they push forward among the crowd, yelling for their name, chanting the initials of North America's number one team. They won the summer split. They're hoping to do well at Worlds. Their third win in the group stage right now at the hands of Splice, as they have one more match to play. And if they can win the next one, they will make top eight at Worlds.
And very crucial that TSM was able to win this game after having a close loss against Samsung. But they're still not out of the woods yet. Everything for TSM is going to come down to their match later against RNG.
It's going to be a tough one. So Splice and TSM, they did battle in a sub 30 minute win. The TSM that their fans expected coming into Worlds. We see them here, we saw the domination. 24-6 in kills.
But another win with a lot of comfort picks here for TSM. Not challenged, really, in pick and ban. The Syndra on Bjergsen, double in Jhin.
It's an interesting story for TSM here at Worlds. Two losses already, 3-2 now, needing to go up against RNG. You can see
how much it means.
They're stressed. They knew this game meant a lot to them, but they still need to do more. For Splice, unfortunately, this means they cannot make the quarterfinals anymore. The dream of a four-way tie at 3-3 is gone. But they're definitely making teams think about them.
Yes.
And they will play. Go ahead.
And their role is like spoiler right now. And yep. They're also not a team that's going to take that lightly.
No.
Splice, at the end of the season, yes, they played a science support once because it didn't really matter in the standings that somewhat. Not so much. But here at Worlds, they really want to prove themselves in the next game. So whoever's next against them, like Samsung now, they will have, honestly, still a chance of losing, because stylistically, a slow team like Splice, like if they play like in Europe, could technically take a game out of Samsung.
Sure. Yeah. I think there's even some camaraderie there, right? You've got the four Danish players here on Splice, two Danish players even on TSM. It's like, all right, we're going to help you guys get through to Worlds. We'll knock down Royal for you. We'll knock down Samsung for you. Do the rest of the work, Bjergsen, everyone else. You know, still, yes, it would leave a great impression on the European fans to have this second week do better for the EULCS. Splice 1-1 in this last week. One more win at least leaves them on a positive note coming Absolutely. Into the next year. It would be nice to see from them. But for now, let's hand it over to the Dash and the boys to check out TSM's win.
And thank you very much, gentlemen. There's the kind of victory we're looking for out of the TSM squad here coming into week two. And unfortunately for Splice, this does mean no quarterfinals for them. Still the opportunity to knock Samsung down a peg or two. But let's dive into this one here and figure out what adjustments TSM made, because this was a very stark contrast between game one and game two, starting in champs.
Well, the first thing is letting Syndra go through is asking for a ball beating back to dodgeball in high school. I mean, you're just going to get beat up nonstop, and that's what Bjergsen did. And the thing that I didn't like about Splice is the fact that they went with a no-pressure matchup into the Vladimir, and we've seen how Syndra to Vlad plays out. Vlad gets pushed in, Syndra has the opportunity to roam. That means that if you pick a top laner that is really volatile, a matchup like a carry into the Gnar, and you have Syndra go into your lane, you're going to lose that lane, and you're not going to have that win condition.
I definitely blame Yamada Cannon here, honestly, with this Splice draft, because you said it perfectly. I feel banning Rumble in the end when you're planning on playing something like Irelia anyway, who can just go up against the Rumble, and you have the same kind of situation where you can try and camp that lane and snowball the Irelia, really doesn't make any sense, because you also end up trading. The first rotation is so important. If you give Syndra, you better get something really, really important on your first rotation to make it worth it. They end up trading Elise for Rek'Sai, so that's like a slight gain maybe for the Elise, and that's it. And the Karma, while she's a good pick, so many other supports to play, so many other different things. We see Alistar, Braum, Nami. Karma definitely doesn't have enough value to be worth giving away Syndra.
And of course, when picking Syndra, you know the Vladimir's into it. The difference as well with Splice is they go for the Irelia, so there's going to be a split pusher, and they end up putting themselves in this awkward 1-3-1 situation where maybe if they had a team fighting top lane or someone that can actually take part with the team and run 4-1, having the Vladimir just go back and forth between lanes, there's a better chance that the pivot would be more effective.
Yeah, because what's going to happen later on in the game is Splice wants to play on all three lanes at the same time. So they want to put Vladimir in the side lane, they want to put Irelia in the other side lane, and then Ezreal sits in mid with the support. the goal for them, or the hope, is that Syndra has to go to that side lane with the Vladimir and defend. And then you isolate her. She's alone. She can't kill the Vladimir. You have a winning side lane there for Splice. Top lane, Irelia has the winning side lane. You have two lanes pushing down. It's all great. Problem is, Syndra is not going to go to that side lane unless she's behind. She's just going to sit mid, wave clear. She can 1v2 the enemy dual lane. And when you have no pressure mid, you can't play side lanes because you can always get roamed on.
And you saw it even in the builds, right? Irelia going for that Blade of the Rune King second is a huge telegraph for I plan on sitting in a side lane against Gnar for the remainder of the game. Now, aside from a repeat weird invade from Svenskeren in game two here, I do want to push past that. The recovery for TSM this time around was much, much better. And this is where I want to look at the roams that they were making. Bjergsen getting out of lane, visiting that top lane, making sure they're keeping Wunder down.
Yeah, I think Team Solo mid is strongest when Bjergsen is on a mid lane pick that can push, and Svenskeren is on a mobile jungler who can gank. And that's exactly what we just saw right here. Mid lane gets pushed up by Bjergsen, he roams to topside, and if you do not call miss instantly and your top laner then just leaves the tower, just give up the wave, leave the tower, he's going to die like we just saw now. So TSM just got like the best picks for them around mid and jungle.
And to your point about calling Mia, the same thing happened in the top side. When the dual lane from TSM recalls, goes straight to the top lane, nobody's calling this out, and you have a Jhin sniping the Irelia with the Braum coming in onto the Gnar, once again putting that split pusher even further behind, and Irelia just never got a foothold in the game. She was unable to put any side lane pressure, and in the team fight, she's just going to get blown up. And that's exactly what happened.
A couple early kills onto Syndra made Bjergsen a monster. And let's take a look at the Acer replay where TSM really put their foot down here in the mid lane. Starts off as a 2v3.
This is a part of the lane assignments to go all wrong here. Vladimir in the bottom lane, Irelia trying to be in side lanes. You have an Ezreal Kamen near the mid. They can get instantly obliterated. And you see exactly that happening, of course, through Bjergsen. As a result of this having a numbers advantage, the team composition of TSM is actually allowed to excel. They've drafted themselves pick and dive, not just poking them down. And it is so easy to combo all of their spells together and make it work.
Yeah, and I think this replay just showed exactly why this comp wasn't going to work for Splice unless Bjergsen fell really far behind. But he didn't. Obviously, he had a great game. This was another good team fight from him. Obviously, a beautiful combo now. You just keep knocking up two members a few times.
A little then trampoline
you kill them,
there.
Then you kill them in the end. So it was this really, really well-played game by TSM. They got exactly the picks they wanted. Bjergsen got to roam. He got revenge from that last game he played against Crown, where he had such a poor start. And we got to see a big difference. When TSM has a mid lane who can't really roam, and especially when he also falls behind, they do very little early to mid game. When they get something like Syndra and they get to push it over and over, they do a lot.
Yeah, player of the game is Bjergsen. Huge contrast between the Zillion game, the Syndra game. And you mentioned the statistic in the two solo deaths mid lane in the first game. Well, here now he's dominant, has a crazy scoreline, 13-1-8.
Yeah, I was a little worried in the beginning because he was missing a lot of CS, but once Svenskeren invaded in a really poor timing and the bot lane of TSM blew all summoners to try to save him, luckily for him, Bjergsen got double buffs off that pick and then was able to, on the backside, kill Trashy as well. And from that advantage, just having that small little lead was able to just snowball so much. And that's what you want to see out of a top-notch player like Bjergsen, being able to take a small lead and translate it into impacting the entire map and just carry the game.
Yeah, I feel like to summarize that point as well, there are players and teams who you don't want to give Aurelion Sol or Syndra to because of the strength of their mid and jungle players. You give them one of them, they outright win the game like that, and Bjergsen very much deserving of that.
All right, well, game three's in the books, and TSM is on the board in week two. When we return from break, Samsung Galaxy and Royal Never Give Up are back on stage. Stay with us.